Well, good morning, everyone. I think we've just passed 10:30 in the morning. Welcome to the Perth Kinross Local Review Body Meeting of the 1st of May 2018. Can I just advise everybody, including members of the public and officers and members, that the today's meeting will be recorded and will be available on the Council's website following the meeting. And the recording starts now. Okay. I just want to introduce the other members of the panel of the LRB today, Councillor Ros McCall on my left, mm-hmm. Councillor Lewis Simpson on my right. In addition to that, Mr. David Harrison on the far right is our planning advisor, Mr. Jeff Fogg on Councillor McCall's left is our legal advisor, and Mr. Danny Williams from Committee Services is on the far left, will be taking the minutes and keeping us right on any procedural matters. I know we have some people from some of the applicants. When we get to your own application, if you give us a gentle wave and just introduce yourself, we'll give you that opportunity. And if I forget to do that, then my colleagues will certainly remind me of that opportunity. In terms of declarations of interest, can I ask if there's any declaration of interest by members on any item of the agenda today?
None from me.
The minute of the previous meeting. Can we note the minute of the last meeting?
Noted.
So we'll now just proceed to the full agenda and take each of the items in turn. The item 4.4.1 is applications for review. A review of the refusal to discharge condition 5 of consent 12 01423 FLL to permit the alternative installation of 7 turbines in Strathmore, as in pages 11 to 164. Do we have anybody here for that one? Yes, we do.
Yes.
Mr. Hubbard, welcome. Okay, that's fine. Okay, Mr. Harrison, over to you to introduce this item.
Thank you, convener. Can I first of all check, can people hear what I'm saying? Is that okay? Thank you. As you say, there's an application in relation to the approval of details as part of condition 5 of the original planning permission for the formation of a wind farm at Tullymurdoch by Aelith. Essentially, the applicant is seeking to erect a different turbine to that put forward at the time of the planning permission for the original proposal. The summary sets out the planning history of the original planning application with the 2012 reference and the later modification by to that planning application, which was in 2015, that equivalent reference, but also the process that has led to this matter being brought before the local review body. Members will be familiar with the local review body summaries being presented, first of all, with the applicant's case, followed by the planning officer's case, as it were. However, in this instance, the planning history and the processing of the proposal is so interrelated that a single joint summary seems more appropriate and hopefully understandable. Consequently, the single summary focuses on the planning considerations and the processes in chronological order since 2012 to today. Normally, at this point, I'd also show photographs of the application site, but I'm familiar there's obviously been a complete landscape impact analysis with photomontages undertaken in the past, so limited photographs for me probably wouldn't be particularly useful. What I'll do is I'll put up the first photograph, hopefully, which is from that landscape assessment. There are other photographs from the assessment if members wish to refer to them, but I'll just leave that up as an example. Turning now in summary, say to joint summary in relation to the applications, the original planning application for the erection of 7 wind turbines and the associated access track and ancillary works was submitted in 2012. The turbine type identified was 120 metres to blade tip, 80 metres to hub level with a blade diameter of some 80 metres. The proposal was subject to an environmental impact assessment covering a wide range of planning considerations on that basis. This proposal was subsequently granted planning permission on appeal, having been refused by the Council's Development Management Committee in September 2014. This consent was subject to many conditions, including condition 5, which required the final specifications of the wind turbines to be submitted for approval before the commencement of development. The full wording of condition 5 is on page 38. The only limitation specified was that the turbines should not exceed 120 metres. Condition 5 and other pre-development conditions were discharged in March 2017 based on the original turbine design. Following the granting of the original planning permission, the planning authority was asked to approve a turbine which was of a reduced height to a blade tip of some 115 metres and some 68 metres to hub level, but with an increased blade diameter of 92 metres, still in terms of condition 5. This turbine, which we'll know as the Cevian MM92, was viewed by the planning officer as being significantly different from that which was assessed in the original application. The planning officer did not consider that he could accept this at that time without a proper assessment of the change. In addition, the environmental statement needed to be revisited to test the potential impact of this alternative turbine. The planning authority did not consider that it was competent to grant planning permission for a development which has to be the subject of an EIA regulation without the necessary environmental assessment being undertaken. A second planning application was therefore required to enable a full assessment of the proposed modification to the proposal. This position was accepted by the then applicant, RDS Element Power Limited, and the second revised planning application was submitted in September 2015, including the revised environmental assessment. The revised environmental assessment had concluded that the Cevian turbines did not create any new significant impacts. The planning permission for the second application was approved by the Council in November 2015. During the summer of 2017, RDS sold its interest in Tully Murdoch Limited to the current applicant, Temporis Capital. In October 2017, the new owner sought approval for the Cevian turbine within the terms of Condition 5 of the original planning permission. They cited the following in support of this submission. Firstly, an appeal decision, and that's the Aries Wind Farm decision, where the reporter concluded that there was such little difference between the original and the subsequent proposal that an application to vary a condition should have been accepted by the planning authority. And secondly, what has been referred to as the Rochdale envelope, which allows for flexibility where the details of a proposal are not finalised at the time of the application being determined. In this case, the turbine specification in the original application was identified as being indicative and potentially subject to change. Additionally, the second application has shown that there would be no new or significantly worse environmental impacts associated with the Cevian turbine. This submission was considered by the planning officer, who maintained the position he had previously taken in 2014, that the revised specification, although it had been shown to be acceptable by virtue of the 2015 consent, could not be accepted under condition 5 of the original 2012 planning permission. He intimated that decision to the applicants in October 2017. In these circumstances, this is an application for review of the planning authority's decision to refuse the application for the Senvion turbine as a revised discharge of condition 5 of the original planning application. It should be further noted that both the original and the second planning application are identical in all respects, with the exception of the wind turbines themselves. The initial site works have been undertaken. Therefore, both the 2012 and the 2015 applications have been implemented and are now capable of being completed using either the original turbine specification or the Senvion MM92 design. The current owner is seeking to have the Senvion turbine directly associated with the original planning application for their own investment reasons. As an ancillary matter, the lawfulness of the 2015 planning permission was challenged in the Court of Session by a third party. The challenge was unsuccessful. The advice to the LRB is that whereas the planning officer did not have sufficient information available to assess the acceptability of the revised turbine specification in 2014, when the issue was revisited by the new applicants in 2017, it is in fact appropriate to have regard to the information which was produced in support of the 2015 application when assessing the environmental impact of change relative to the 2012 application. In this case, there is no request for a site visit, but there is a request for a hearing, the purpose of which is to enable the applicant to present a number of legal matters in relation to the officer's view that the change in turbine type is a material change, if necessary. Thank you, Jim.
Thanks, Mr. Harrison. There's a history, obviously, to this request for a review, and thank you for summarising it succinctly, but still thoroughly. Given that there's been a lot of process information presented to us today, and that's presented within the report, and we also have, I think, sufficient information on the proposal as the amended blade size and configuration, that I think we can make a view on that, but we'll decide whether we have sufficient information in a moment. Questions, first of all, to Mr. Harrison and or to Mr. Frog. Councillor McCall.
I have no questions, Convener, thank you.
Councillor Simpson.
I have no questions on this one, Convener.
Mr. Harrison and Mr. Fogg, given that we've had a summary of the situation, including the legal issues, is there any other information that you think we need to be available to us that we don't have within the written material, which is 164 pages worth, and the summary that you want to draw to our attention? That's good. Do we feel we've got sufficient information to proceed to a decision on this?
I am happy we have sufficient information, Convener.
Also happy, Convener.
Then I think we should proceed. Yes, indeed, we have a lot of information before us today. I think it's within the remit of the LRB to come to a decision on this today and to tidy up a process that's been lengthy and at times difficult. And I would propose, therefore, that we move approval of the application and grant the reasons for the review according to the papers that we've got before us. Do I have any other views, Councillor Simpson?
No, I'm in agreement with you, Convener.
Councillor McCall?
I am also in agreement. I think we should agree this paper.
Mr. Harrison, are there any particular points you want to draw attention to in terms of conditions, given the lengthy history of this matter, and Mr. Fogg?
Convener, that this is slightly different from a normal application that's before you, because it's not a full application. It's simply approval of an application to discharge a condition. So it would therefore require a slightly different decision notice, which I think Mr. Harrison and I are confident we can draft on your behalf. I don't think there's a requirement for any other conditions associated with approval, unless Mr. Harrison feels I've overlooked something.
No, that's essentially what I was going to draw to your attention. It's a different sort of proposal you have in front of you today. It's really quite unique in that sense. It's really to do with the discharge of a condition, not a new decision notice.
Thank you. I just wanted to clarify that. I think we're confident to leave it in your hands to draft the appropriate letter and correspondence on the matter. Are we agreed on that?
Agreed.
Well, Mr. Hubbard, that's the end of what's been a long saga. I hope that the development can now proceed and get on with generating some electricity, rather maybe more electricity than heat and light that's been in the past, if we could use that metaphor. Okay. Thank you for your attendance today. You're more than welcome to stay, but no doubt you've got other things to do. I should have said at the beginning we have in attendance Mrs. Christine Bryan from the Planning Service from Perth Kinross as an observer on our deliberations, and I apologise for not introducing you at the beginning of the meeting, as I usually do. Thank you. We're now going on to application 4.2. It's a planning application for the erection of a dwelling house in principle and land north of 59 Station Road, Invergowrie. And I think we're back over to you, Mr. Harris.
Thank you, Convener.
Do we have anybody? I don't think we have anybody for Station Road at Invergowrie unless they've popped into the room in the last few minutes. No. Okay, on you go.
Thank you. As you say, it's a planning application in principle for the erection of a dwelling house at 59 Station Road in Invergowrie. The site is formed by the side garden area of this traditional stone and slate detached house, which is set above Station Road. There are other traditional houses on each side and a modern housing estate on the opposite side of the road and semi-detached local authority housing to the rear. The existing access and parking space would be used to serve the proposed house. It is envisaged that a new parking area would be formed in the front garden area of the existing house. And I'll just take you through the photographs now, but you might like to have page 179 onwards, which provides you with the location plan and the site plan. The general sequence of the photographs will be approaching the site from the south, the site from Station Road, looking out from within the site, and then the housing development, which is opposite. So this is, as standing in Station Road, looking down the row of older properties which are set above Station Road, and in the far distance, as it were, you can see the last of this three group of traditional houses, number 59. And swinging round slightly to the right of that photograph, we're looking there down, as it were, more down the full length of Station Road, looking in that easterly direction. And the site, as you can see from this angle, is between number 59 and number 61 beyond. Swinging round a little bit again to the right of that photograph, we have some of the modern housing on the opposite side of the road. Moving on from that, we go, as it were, to look directly into some of the parking areas, and this is just to show you the gap which exists between the two existing traditional houses, numbers 57 and 59 there in that instance, and as I say, the parking area has been formed in front of number 57. Swinging round to the right of that, we catch the application site and the gap in that instance, and the gap also between those two properties we were looking at earlier. Again, swinging round to the right of that photograph, we see that gap which forms the application site more clearly, and you can see there's a fairly high partial retaining wall on the Station Road frontage there, and then it drops down where we have the existing access serving what was presently the house, but would serve the site itself in the event of a house being built. Moving on from that again, this is us now looking directly opposite the site, obviously number 59 in the foreground there, and as you can see the access in that photograph too. Swing round to the right of that photograph, we're still getting the application site and just the gable of number 59, but this is beginning to show you the boundary in relation to number 61 with its garage in the frontage there and obviously its garden ground too. And you can probably just make out some of the local authority housing in the far distance behind the application site as well. Again, swinging around to the right of that photograph, we see numbers, the same detached copy, properties, number 61 and 63, and of course the garage there too. Moving on from that, the site in detail, and this particular photograph is to show you the photographs which are referred to in the officer's report, which are gable on to the application site and, shall we say, the prospective house. Moving on from that, we see on the opposite side the window in the gable of number 61, which of course is set further back from the application site boundary. And finally, to the rear, this is us looking, as it were, over the fence towards the houses, the local authority houses to the rear. So swinging round from that, we see the garden ground at the rear of number 61 and 63. This is us now at the higher level within the application site, of course. Swinging to the right of that, we're now looking out from that higher level, excuse me, towards the modern housing on the opposite side of Station Road. Swinging round from the right of that, again, we catch the gable with the two windows and the modern houses at that lower level. And then swinging round again to the right of that, we catch the rear garden areas of 59 and 57. And just for clarity, these are the houses on the opposite side of the road from the application site. This is number one. And then swinging to the right of that, on the other side of the entrance, we have the other property. Moving on from that, just show you an illustration of the houses in Noble Avenue. These are the houses which back onto the application site. So I'll just leave you with that general photograph. Turning first of all in summary to the applicant's case, an earlier detailed application for this proposal was submitted in 2010. This was refused by the council and by the local review body due to the narrowness of the site and the density of development in comparison to the character of the area. The application was assessed in relation to the previous Perth Area Local Plan of 1995. The proposal is being revisited in relation to the current development plan policies PM1A and PM1B concerning placemaking and RD1 concerning residential areas and the relevant government policies and guidance. There are a variety of house types and plot sizes in the locality relating to the different PEs when they were built. It is envisaged that the house would be single story and of a form to reflect its neighbours. As such, it would make a positive contribution to the character of the area and the housing land supply, providing residential development at a density that makes an efficient use of land while respecting its environs. The indicative plan, together with the assessment of the adjoining plot areas, widths and lengths, is seen as demonstrating that a house could be developed without adversely affecting the character and comparative density of the surrounding area. The proposed plot has 1. An area of some 540 square metres, 2. Could maintain the same building line, 3. Is separated from the main elevations of the neighbours by more than 18 metres regarding privacy and overlooking, and 4. Has comparable garden ground. Further boundary landscaping could be undertaken through a planning condition. In conclusion, the proposal is seen as complying with local development plan policies PM1A, PM1B and RD1. The proposal is also seen as complying with policies PM4 and TA1B due to its position within a settlement boundary with access to all modes of transport. Turning now in summary of the officer's report of handling, the site is approximately 14 metres in width and between 37 and 40 metres in depth. The indicative footprint suggests a modest house, presumably with accommodation on two levels, set back by about a metre from the boundaries on each side. The local development plan encourages infill development within settlements where this can be undertaken with respect to the surrounding environs. A house would be compatible in terms of its residential land use. At some 550 square metres, the site is capable of providing for the minimum standard of 100 square metres of usable garden ground. While the width of the site would seem to have been increased by about 1 metre in comparison to the 2010 proposal, the narrowness of the site and the proximity of the prospective house to its neighbours continues to be seen as resulting in the proposal being, and I use the term, squeezed in, as quoted from the report. This is viewed as being out of character with the area and visually incongruous. It would be very close to number 59, which has two windows at first floor level on the adjoining gable. The presence of the proposed house is seen as potentially having an adverse impact on the residential amenity of the future occupants of that house. In this case, there are no representations. There is a request for a site visit, but no request for a hearing. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison. Questions, first of all, Councillor Simpson.
Again, I have no questions on this one, Convener, thank you.
Councillor McCall.
I equally have no questions, sorry.
One or two questions from the Convener. It says in the report that there's an issue about only 1 metre of space being available on either side of the house if it's built as proposed. And the application is in principle, but there's an indicative line drawn there. Is Mr. Harrison, is that your correct reading of the situation?
Well, it does vary a little bit. The indicative drawings do have slightly different dimensions, but all I could really say is that it is an indicative drawing. We don't know what, if consent was granted, what would actually come in as the proposal. I think the assumption here is that in order to be a detached house, they would have to be almost a minimum of a metre on each side of the building, if only to allow for access to from the front to the back of the building. And that's why I think the officer has assumed, considering the narrowness of the site, that there would be very limited, land between the building and the boundaries.
And am I right in thinking that's a bigger issue, space between houses, apropos number 59, which is right next door to the site. I'm now looking at the plan where the red line looks as if it's almost cheek to jowl to number 59, whereas in 63 there's an element of space between the proposed house and the number 61.
61, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, I mean, if you turn to page, for example, 205, it shows you how what I've tried to represent in the photograph. It shows you, as you say, the boundary adjacent to number 59 as being really just stepped off from the building by approximately a metre, and the garden ground on the opposite side of number 61, of course, is much more extensive.
On pages 188 and 189, the applicant's agent is making the case for density issues in surrounding houses, some of which are in Station Road and quite a lot are in Noble Avenue. Mm. Have you any comments to make on that submission and its relevance to the current application?
In looking at the table, you might also want to look at... page 180, which shows these roads.
Yes. Yes.
And what you see is the Noble Avenue is the local authority or former local authority housing, which backs onto the application site, It's principally semi-detached rather than detached housing. As you'll probably even see from this photograph, if a house was to be built on the site here, you wouldn't tend to see it in relation to Noble Avenue's properties because of the house being set up from the road, but obviously it would obscure that. So you really should probably concentrate, if you're thinking in terms of density and character, more in relation to the Station Road side. But also, and I do note that in looking at the density aspect, the table doesn't tend to take in the modern properties on the opposite side of the road as part of the table. It concentrates solely on one side of Station Road and Noble Avenue, whereas if a house was to be being built there, you would tend to see it more in relation to Station Road and Boniface Road and Place.
Okay. And I take the point regarding the houses in Noble Avenue, which are familiar to me from old school days many, many years ago, but these particular houses, I think, are local authority or former local authority houses that had very large gardens. You'll see from the plans on page 180, the gardens are extremely large. I think they could grow enough vegetables there to keep you all winter safely, but they are. So I take the point about the relative comparisons that's there. And these were my two questions. Do either of my colleagues have any other points to raise or questions?
No.
Do you feel, Councillor McCall, that we have sufficient information to proceed, given with the report we've had and all the written material we've got to make a decision?
Yes. Okay.
Councillor Simpson?
Yes, I too am happy we have sufficient information, Convener.
I concur. I think we've had a full report, and there's a lot of detail, and the applicant's agent has provided us with a lot of material here that we've read very thoroughly. Councillor Simpson, would you like to take a lead in this one, please?
Thank you, Convener. I think having reflected on this and seen this, I see no reason to change the previously expressed views of the LRB as to the size of the plot and any appropriate nature of its development. So I am content to go with the reasons of refusal as stated in the papers, Convener.
Councillor McCall.
Thank you, Convener. I have to say I agree with Councillor Simpson. There is nothing I've read in the report which is very comprehensive, which changes the details that from the previous refusal. I know this is an in principle application for what would be proposed to be a single story, but I have concerns over the size of the plot, what actually kind of story single-storey dwelling you could put on that, and with the close proximity of windows on the adjacent house really has some major concern, and I don't think any of these have been addressed with the information that has been put forward. So and I agree with the reasons for refusal have been previously stated.
Thank you. I tend to concur with the views and that we should sustain the refusal as outlined on page 203. There's only one reason for refusal, and I don't think I've got anything to add to that. Mr. Harrison, Mr. Fogg, have you any advice to give on procedure or propriety as far as that's concerned?
I have nothing further.
No, absent, nothing further.
Therefore, we have a unanimous decision to agree to the refusal of the application. We're now on to item 5, deferred applications for review. Both these applications have been the subject of review before, but the LRB at the time decided to seek further information and detail on them, and that information has now been received. The first one of these is item 5.1, planning application for the erection of a dwelling house, land 400 metres northeast of Lee Park, Corain. And we have Mr. McFadyen, who is the applicant, with us this morning. Welcome again, Mr. McFadyen. I think this is a return visit for you. Mr. Harrison, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. This is a detailed planning application for the erection of a house on land 400 metres northeast of Lee Park, Coldrain. And I'll just take you to the photographs immediately. Oh, this seems to have changed. You might like to have page 305 onwards, which provides you with a location plan and the site plan, drawings of the proposed house also. Page 371 shows the additional land that the applicant has acquired also. Now, I'm noticing that the display doesn't seem to give the photographs clearly. Lost it again.
Can maybe try again, Mr. Harris.
It's coming up here, but not on the screen. Thanks very much. The general sequence of the photographs are going to be the site from the public road, which is what you see in the photograph here, followed by the proposed house site, and then the existing buildings and the adjoining land. So, let's say the first photograph, to take you back to that, this is us standing on the public road, looking at the entry and down the track towards the application site. And the arrow is obviously identifying in general terms where that is relative to the woodland. Moving on from that, as it were, down the track to that site, this is us now adjacent to the application site, to some extent looking back towards the public road, and the next sequence of photographs will swing round towards the left, but this is the first part of the application site, and then moving round to the left, looking across the application site towards that block of woodland, in a southerly direction, swing round again to the left of that photograph. We're still looking at the woodland, but we're also looking at the site and the pond, which is referred to in the papers, looking generally in an easterly direction, and then again swinging round to the left of that photograph. This is a slightly different position, but looking across the applicant's field in the easterly direction. And this is looking across the fields, say, closest to the application site, say, towards the Lomond Hills there. Moving slightly to the left of that photograph, we're looking in a more northerly direction this time, again across farmland, which is part of the applicant's holding, but in this case we're looking towards the Ojo Hills and the A977. Swinging round again to the left of that photograph, we see part of the yard area and of course the existing shed, and this is the yard area, of course, is the area which has got consent for a second shed to be erected. Moving on from that, we look down the gable of the existing shed back towards the site and of course the block of woodland beyond. And as we're moving down, we see the shed itself, and then swinging slightly to the left of that, we see a caravan oblique building which is also on the site and the corner of the shed. Moving on from that, just to give you a bit more detail of that building, and then swinging around to the left of that, we look across the application site as well, in that generally in a southerly direction. So I'll just leave you with that general photograph. Turning first of all in summary of the applicant's case. The applicant currently runs South Balado Farm, which extends to some 250 acres. This is divided between two separate blocks of land, a lesser area to the west, acquired in 2009, and a larger area to the east, acquired in 2017. A farm building was erected on the western block in 2010, and a second farm building has consent to be erected. The buildings are and will be used for storing machinery and for livestock. The proposed house would be sited beside these buildings in the western block. The applicant also operates a construction and agricultural and industrial building fabrication and farm equipment repair business. That business employs two workers. This application follows initial consultations and revisions to the proposal. The farming activities are based on cattle and sheep rearing and fattening, with some ancillary fodder and cereal production. There is considered to be a need for a permanent residential presence on the site for the care and management of livestock and the ongoing security of animals and machinery. Turning first of all regarding reason one, the farming activities commenced some 7 years ago and are seen as being established. The SAC report, based on current livestock and crops, exceeds one labour unit in its assessment. The business is projected to expand. The proposed house would be adjacent to the existing and proposed buildings and would oversee the land from this central position. Regarding reason two, the position of the proposed house has been moved to be closer to the buildings than originally envisaged. It would have minimal impact on the surrounding landscape, being some 300 metres from the nearest public road. The existing earth banking would screen the ground floor as seen from the Bilado to Cleish Road, giving the impression that this is a single-storey house. The curved and sloping style of the roof and its broken gutter line is also seen as minimising its visual impact, achieving a storey and a half rather than a two-storey building. The design is seen as being innovative and vibrant. Regarding reason three, attention is drawn to a number of recently erected two-storey houses in the locality. These are considered to have a greater presence and impact on the landscape than the proposal, which seeks to reflect the adjoining agricultural shed. The house would have a lesser mass than the shed, which has been approved by the council. Regarding reason four, farm buildings and yards are not, are not generally sited within settlement boundaries. The farm building and yard has been accepted by the council, and it is reasonable for an associated house to be located on the edge of that development. Turning now in summary to the officer's report of handling, the proposal concerns the erection of a house for a key worker for which the Local Development Plan Policy RD3 and the Associated Housing in the Countryside Guide 2014 are the main considerations. The main aims of the guide are to, firstly, safeguard the character of the countryside, secondly, support the viability of communities, thirdly, meet development needs in appropriate locations, and fourthly, ensure that high standards of siting and design are achieved. The site lies out with any settlement boundary and falls to be assessed against Category C of the policy for new houses in the open countryside. Regarding the need for a key worker's dwelling, the policy requires the economic activity to be consented or established. The construction of a house will not be permitted in advance of the development of the business. In this case, the labour unit requirement was assessed as being 0.8 of a unit in October 2016 and 1.09 of a unit in January 2017. This, of course, has been updated. It is noted that the additional hours are based on a forecast. Notwithstanding the additional information submitted, it is not considered that a sufficiently robust case has been submitted to support the need for an essential workers' house at this stage. It is recognised that temporary accommodation may allow the economic activity case for a house to be demonstrated at some point in the future. Regarding the design and layout, it is noted that the design seeks to reflect the adjoining agricultural building. The proposed form of roundels breaking through the eaves line is seen as overly complex, and the design would benefit from being simplified. In addition, the proposed siting, height, and mass of the proposed building is seen as eroding the character of the countryside. A single-storey building would be likely to address these concerns. However, this proposal is viewed as being contrary to Local Development Plan Policies PM1A, PM1B, Part A and B, and ER6. Regarding drainage considerations within the Loch Leven catchment area, SEPA has confirmed that the proposed phosphorus mitigation measures are sufficient, subject to appropriate conditions requiring the proposed upgrading of facilities serving Kinshiel, Kinniswood. In this case, there are no representations. But I will go on to summarise the supplementary information, which is on page 355 onwards, submitted in response to your request. The planning application and the associated SEC report was based on the western block of land only. The applicant introduced the eastern block of land at the notice of review stage, which has led to the revised SEC report being requested by the local review body. The labour requirement has changed from being 1.09 to 1.2, with the addition of 60 hectares in the eastern block. That is in addition to the 40 hectares in the western block. The new report indicates that the additional eastern block of land is seen as providing for cereal crop production and grassland. It also indicates that the two workers and the operation of the construction business have not been taken into account in preparing the revised SAC. The planning officer has the following comments on the revised SAC report. A different labour profile method has been used for crops in the previous and revised reports. Also, the coefficients for calculating the labour requirements for stock is not consistent between the reports, and this changes the results so that an increase of some 350 hours has been added to the calculation. It is considered that clarification is needed to explain the decrease in the area identified for forestry, the change coefficient for suckler cows, and an update so that cereals are assessed in terms of acreage. In this case, there was a request for both a site visit and also a request for a hearing. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison. I want to draw particular attention to the further information that's been provided by the agents for Mr. McFadden, and in fact, on page 359 onwards, the SAC report, and particularly the plan that I thought was helpful on 371, along with Mr. Russell from the Planning Services commentary on that. Questions for Mr. Harrison? Councillor Simpson.
Thank you. I wonder, Mr. Harrison, could we go back to the photograph that shows the caravan building? That one there. And can you give me an indication on maybe perhaps on page 308 of the site of that building?
If you're looking at page 308, the best way of maybe describing it, if you see where it says site area, and there is an indication next to that with an annotation saying existing access road and hard standing, it's slightly, as it were, to the northern side of that. You may remember in the previous, I think it's the previous photograph, you're just catching the corner of the shed, which you have in your plan there. So it's tighter, it's closer into the shed than that indication.
Thank you. And further, do we have any information on the purpose of that building?
As you say, it's not actually on the plan you have here. It would appear to be, and I'm sort of, I suspect it's probably at least a messing facility for somebody when they're on site. Whether it's used for a residential purpose, I really don't have complete clarity on that.
Thank you very much. No further questions.
Councillor McCall.
No, I have no questions. They were answered in your summary, so thank you, Mr. Harrison.
The one or two questions from myself. Just the caravan, first of all, since we're at that picture, does it enjoy consent?
I'm not aware of it enjoying consent.
Okay.
I mean, in the sense that I don't think it's actually referred to in terms of the officer's report. I'll just let me check that for you.
I wasn't clear from reading the material if that was the case. Um, we don't normally encourage dialogue, as you know, but since you're here, now to courtesy, what is the caravan used for, Mr. McFadden? That's helpful. That's helpful. We note that. And the second shed, Mr. Harrison, is proposed to be, which has consented, and you outlined that. I'm just checking my hearing correct, that you the main purpose of that is for agricultural purposes, to store materials, agricultural materials, to store machinery, and also to allow shelter for stock. Am I right in that?
The drawing, the information you have here doesn't give details of it, but I understand it's, to the rear of the existing shed, as it were, on the northern side of the existing shed. And if I can just maybe check the... I'm assuming that the officer's report on page 321, which gives a site history, refers to the erection of an agricultural building under what's called prior notification process. And there seem to be two, as it were, references to it, but one was one being withdrawn there. But my understanding is that it enjoys consent for a second shed.
And I think in your summary, I think you made the point that the applicant's agent had indicated that this was for agricultural.
Yes, I have no reason to think it isn't another second agricultural building.
If it were to be used for livestock, is there a potential access issue in getting to the shed, given it's behind the existing shed, which is used primarily for the other business that's operated on site?
I'm not quite sure what you mean, access, what, and simply in terms of animals being able to enter and leave it. I think that would really be a matter of management for the the farmer rather than for ourselves.
Okay, that's fine. The application is for the house primarily for a key worker to look after livestock. Is that my interpretation of what the applicant's summary was?
Yes, that is the supporting information through the SAC reports is what is supporting that case for.
Yeah, and it's primarily towards livestock husbandry.
Well, there is livestock husbandry, and the applicant certainly talks about that in relation to this particular locality. The additional land which you see in the, shall we say, the eastern block seems to be identified principally for cereal and grassland production.
I just want that takes me conveniently to page 371, where we have a helpful plan which is produced as part of the applicant's further information. And there are several blocks outlined in blue on that plan. Could you just summarise the sequence of the blocks, Mr. Harrison, in relation to the application? Because there's a west block, I think,
yes,
what looks like a south block, and an east block.
My understanding is there's only really, shall we say, two blocks involved here.
Right.
The west block, as you describe it, as it were, the one in the lower part of the page, as it were, is the original application site, which was submitted. The eastern block, the more sort of L-shaped block, has been land acquired by the applicant since the submission of the original planning application. As you can see, there are two blocks here which have a field in between them, separating them. I'm not aware of there actually being a direct connection between them as such, other than obviously going on the public road. But that's the sequence of events. The western block was purchased first as bare land, and then, my understanding, the second block also bought as bare land in 2017.
Okay, thank you. And my final comment is just in relation to Mr. Russell's email dated the 12th of April 2018, which is helpful in summarising the issues in the SAC report, but also his final paragraph. He's asking, I think, for further clarification. Maybe it's a question for Mr. Fogg as much as Mr. Harrison, but do you feel this further information would be useful to the LRB as well as to the planning service?
I think that's essentially a question you have to answer for yourselves. I'm not sure I could have a personal view. Clearly, all information is inherently a good thing. If you were generally persuaded, you might feel that the further information or clarifications being referred to would not be necessary and therefore add to expense and delay. On the other hand, if you were not wholly persuaded by the original SAC report and the supplementary report, but getting clarification would be beneficial, then yes, indeed, it may well be appropriate that you do further defer. So it depends to what extent you are
I'm not deciding or not. I'm just looking at all the options before us. I'll allow you one more sentence, Mr. McFadden. Thank you. Clarification of facts is always helpful. Thank you for that. Okay, I don't think I've any more questions at this stage. Councillor Simpson, Councillor McCall, have you any more?
No, I'm fine.
Okay.
I'm quite content, Convener, thank you.
Do we consider we have sufficient information, both given the written material, the extra material we've had before us on this occasion, and also Mr. Harrison's presentation to proceed to decision?
I'm happy we have sufficient information, Convener.
I believe we do.
Well, would you like to?
Thank you, Convener. The extra information provided from this being deferred has been extremely helpful in this particular case, and I'm actually confident with the information that comes in that the proposed plan of the two sites that have been put there, that a key worker dwelling would be necessary to take this business forward. Unfortunately, I have concerns more on the property that is proposed. The information that has come forward, it is difficult for me to see how this is a key worker dwelling, and I have concerns on that front. So as much as I am very pleased with the extra information and agree that a key worker dwelling should go ahead, I have concerns on the dwelling itself under PM1BC within the local development plan.
We'll ask for clarification on that point in a moment, but Councillor Simpson first.
I'm in agreement with Councillor McCall. I think it is heartening that an applicant listens to us and does come back with the extra information. But I too am uncomfortable and I am with the particular dwelling suggested, and I think that we would need to go with certain of the reasons recommended already.
my opening line on decision making is I feel on balance that it would be useful to have the further information that outlined in Mr. Russell's email. However, I'm conscious of the fact that this application has been on the go for some time and there's a cost and other implication for the applicant. So since I'm in a minority, I'm not going to press for that or take anybody to task about their decision at all. I think what we're moving towards is a decision where we consider that the new information that's available to us from the SAC report gives sufficient balance of evidence to allow a key worker's house, but the proposed design scale and massing of the house is something that we don't feel that we can support at this stage. Now, I would just take everybody to page 303, I think, in the papers, and I'll set aside my request for further information because I'm in a minority of one on that. And I think that the reasons for refusal, and I need to say this directly to Mr. McFadyen, he's in the room. This is, a step forward, but my own personal view, and I have this irrespective of my earlier view, is that the house is very large for a key worker, for a stockman, basically. And whilst some justification has been given of other houses that are around in the countryside that have been approved, I consider the scale and design and massing of this one to be inappropriate to the location and also to the purpose of being a house for a key worker, a stock person. And therefore, I think that you, Councillor McCall, are moving refusal on grounds 2 and 3 on page 303, but that grounds 3 would read, the proposals contrary to policy PM1B criteria C,
yes,
rather than A.
Yes.
Now, Mr. Fogg, keep us right on the technicalities, and Mr. Harrison on that. So it would be proposal, reason 2 on page 303 and reason 3. Reasons 1 and 4, obviously, would pass.
What you've said, Convener, is consistent with certainly the sentiment expressed by Councillors McCall and Simpson, and therefore it would be in order that it becomes the two reasons only, and reasons 1 and 4 would fall in the decision notice. I don't have any further clarification to seek.
No, I have nothing more to add to what Mr. Fogg has said.
Thank you. Sorry, I've withdrawn my request for further information. I think that would be a unanimous decision. Mr. McFadyen, you'd be happy with a bit of that and unhappy with another bit of it, I suspect. But I think it gives you the opportunity to look in support of a revised application that would have a different design of house type. And I've no doubt the planning service would be able to give support and advice and help in that regard. Okay, I think we've given it a fair deliberation. Thank you very much indeed for your attendance today and your additional information, which we appreciated. Our final item for this morning is item 5.2, the erection of a dwelling house and stables on land 90 metres west of Vendetti Farm at Kinross. And hello again. Thank you for waiting. Mr. Matthew. Yep. Okay. Thank you. And this this one, just by way of introduction, we did have a look at this before, but we sought further information and clarification on the exact siting of the house, because the previous papers had two plans. In fact, we've still got two plans, but we've now clarified that the plan on page 485 of the papers is the plan. And I'd like you now to nod, Mr. Matthew, because that will help us in our deliberations. Okay, that's right. And that coincides with the plan on, and we'll try and find it quickly. 435, and is not the plan that's on 425. I'm being deliberate about this, Mr. Harrison, but I just want to make sure everybody's on the same page with us, because that caused confusion the last time. And there's certainly no confusion in my mind now. Okay, Mr. Harrison, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. This is a detailed planning application for the erection of a dwelling house and stables at land 90 metres west of Fintate Farm, Kinross. The site extends to some 0.5 hectares, including a paddock. Part of the site overlaps land identified for landscaping as part of the chalet development to the west. The site would be a three-bedroom, single-storey property with an integral garage. The walls would be finished externally in a combination of render and Caithness effect coins. The roof would be in slate effect cement roof tiles. The house would be set back some 30 metres from the public road. The brick-built stables would provide accommodation for three horses and associated storage. Access would be via an existing entry and is shown as linking with the chalet development. I'll just take you through the photographs now, but you might like to have pages 433 onwards, which provide the location plan and the site plan and drawings of the house. These, of course, are different from the layout shown on page 425, in which the applicant has confirmed are not the site layout, which is the subject of the review. The plan showing the adjoining chalets is on page 459. The general sequence of the photographs would be approaching from the west and the chalets, the farmhouse and farm buildings, the site, and then the existing houses. So I say this is us approaching from a westerly direction, looking east as it were, and you could just pick up the chalets, which are set down slightly below the road at this point, the red line indicating the general position of the proposed house, and of course the farmhouse itself slightly in silhouette there, looking in that direction. So if we move on from that into the chalet site itself, this is, as I say, within the cul-de-sac there, looking past the chalets in the opposite direction, say looking west this time, just catching a little bit of Loch Leven there, and of course the rising hill at the background too. Moving on from that, this is us now on the other side of the application site. This is the farmhouse and of course the garden ground in front of the farmhouse, and you'll begin to pick up one or two of the agricultural buildings beyond that, which will come up in later photographs. Moving on from that, we now move, we're standing basically in the access, that's part of the existing access running into the application site, looking across some clear ground and the most immediate agricultural building towards the farmhouse. And then we swing round to the left of that photograph and we get this adjoining farmyard and shed, and below that you might notice another building set at a lower level, and that will come up in later photographs. But this is the building that's closest to the proposed house. Moving towards the left of that photograph, we're now swinging round, and this is the entry into the application site, and you can pick up the roofs of the closest chalets there beyond the red line, and just a little bit of Loch Leven as well. Swing round to the right of that photograph slightly. We're now stepping into the application site, looking back, I see, at the farmhouse, and the level of the farmhouse ridge is shown there as well. And the ridge of the house by comparison is identified, just to give you an indication of that too. Swinging round slightly to the left of that photograph. We look down to the ridge level that's identified on the, and it's described as the adjoining building. It's actually that building rather than the closest one. And again, the levels are there for comparison. This is looking down that boundary of the application site towards the Lomond Hills and, of course, Loch Leven. Swinging round to the left of that, we're looking down the main body, as it were, of the site, looking in a northerly direction. This would be towards the paddock area. Swinging round to the left of that photograph, we look again, and you can see a little bit more of the break and slope here, but this now takes in the adjoining chalet development. Swinging round to the left of that, again, we see the road and that boundary adjacent to the public road. Moving on from that, just to give a little more background, there's obviously an existing farm enterprise operating on the other side of the farmhouse. Excuse me. And then again, moving on from that, there are two houses referred to in the papers on the opposite side of the road, which seem to be associated with the original farm. This is what I might describe as house number one, the one closest to the public road. And then swinging round to the left of that, and we're taking in house number one, but also the gable of house number two. And swinging round to the left of that, we can see house number two. So I'll just leave you with that general photograph of the site. Turning first of all in summary to the applicant's case, the proposed house is viewed as complying completely with Local Development Plan Policy RD3 and the Housing in the Countryside Guide as an infill development which also extends a building group. It is also seen as according with policies PM1A, PM1B and ER6. The application site is considered to be a gap site between the farm building group and the chalet development. It enjoys a 50 metre frontage onto the B9097 and would provide a logical and appropriate extension of the building group. It is considered that the chalets and the farm buildings provide a setting and backdrop for the proposed house. The chalets are seen as being of a size of a small cottage. The site is also seen as having strongly defined boundaries that could be added to by additional planting. The house is not seen as being prominent in this locality. It is recognised that part of the chalet site, previously identified for landscaping, has been included within this application site. The local review body are invited to make the carrying out of the landscaping a condition of the house being occupied. As such, the proposed house is not seen as having an adverse impact on the chalet development. Access is satisfactory. There is no conflict between the proposed residential and farming land uses. There are no adverse impacts on protected locations, and the development is seen as having the potential to enhance biodiversity. It would be in line with the existing buildings and is not considered to form ribbon development. The design and materials are also considered to respect the rural character of the location. The proposal is seen as having an economic impact in allowing the existing farmer to be provided with a retirement house, thereby enabling his existing house on the opposite side of the road to be occupied by a future farm worker. Attention is also drawn to the Scottish Government's general broad policies in support of rural development, including housing. Turning now in summary to the officer's report of handling, the proposal falls to be assessed in relation to Local Development Plan Policy RD3 and the associated Housing in the Countryside guidance, notably building groups and infill criteria. The existing farm contains a range of buildings which are seen as constituting a building group. The policy and guidance allows for the extension of such groups into a definable site formed by existing topography or well-established landscape features. This site is very open and is only defined by post and wire fencing on its west and southern boundaries. It has no definition on its north boundary. Consequently, it has not been assessed as meeting this criteria. The site lies between the farmsteading buildings and the approved and partly constructed chalet development. Planning policy and guidance indicates that the development of infill sites of up to two houses can be supported where this completes the gap between an established house and another substantial building. However, in this case, the nearest buildings are the holiday chalets to the west and the modern farm shed to the east. Consequently, the site is not considered to meet the criteria for an acceptable infill site in terms of the type and size of the adjoining buildings. The ridge height of the proposed house would be only 0.75 metres lower than the three-storey farmhouse, which is set further back and down from the public road. In this context, the development is seen as being prominent within the Loch Leven and Lomond Hills special landscape area. The proposed use of part of the landscaping area approved for the chalet development as a paddock ground makes it doubtful if the planting will be carried out or retained. In addition, the landscaping identified as part of this proposal is not seen as sufficient to provide an effective setting for a house on this most elevated part of the site. It is considered that such a prominent building would have an adverse visual impact on the locality and in relation to the farmhouse and its steading. In this case, there has been one representation. Port Mooc Community Council has recommended that the house be moved north and further down the slope, more in line with the existing farmhouse, to reduce its impact as seen from the public road. In this case, there is a request for a site visit, but no request for a hearing. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Harrison. Questions on this one? Councillor McCall.
Thank you, Convener. Could we go back to the picture that showed the farm dwellings at the side of the site? I'm trying to get an indication based on the Port Mooc Community Council and an idea of where on the site it's going to be in relation to these buildings and to the farmhouse. Right. I know that might be difficult, but I'm just trying to get an indication of where on the site that's going to come.
That picture gives an excellent foreground of a pile of tyres.
Yes.
I think there's other information in it as well. Yep.
I'm just thinking what plan would be best to. I think if you turn to page 438, mm-hmm. I'm looking at this picture. The building you see there, which is the larger lower set building, which appears on page 437. You've got the two buildings adjacent to the site shown there. Okay. The larger building, the more northerly building that is, adjacent to the application site is the one you're looking at in that photograph. So the house is, shall we say, closer to being opposite where you see the tyres, as it were, rather than down the slope adjacent to that lower set building.
Are the tyres, pardon me interjecting, but are the tyres roughly where the wee building is? The grey building on page 437?
Let's see if we can pick up some of them. They're further down the slope. The wee building is the building you see in this photograph.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
And you're probably just catching the corner of the tyres in the extreme left of that photograph. They're out of sight, as it were. So the tyres aren't opposite the gable of the wee building, they're between the two buildings and further down the slope.
Right.
So if I go back to that's a bit further down the slope.
Sorry,
No, that's helpful. I'm just trying to have an idea in my head. Obviously, if we look at page 437,
yes.
It's the indication on that as to where the house would be built. Are we saying it is beside, if we look at this on a sort of horizontal level, the building that's there, the grey building in the middle, or are we saying it's slightly further down, nearer where the tyres would be?
I think if you imagine where I was standing taking the photograph, that's possibly just looking at it. That's probably more or less in line with the rear of the proposed house. If you were to turn towards the left of the photograph horizontally along.
Right. Yes, I think I've got that. Thank you. It's just so that I can have an indication as to the sort of, as Portmoke Community Council are raising a concern as to the position of the house, I was trying to work out where that would be in relation to the farmhouse and the buildings roundabout. But I think you've answered my question. Thank you.
Councillor Simpson.
Councillor McCall has covered my point.
Thank you. That's the benefit of coming first. Just sticking on page 437, and to pick up the Community Council's observation, I think, this Mr. Harrison, technically, could the house be further north, further towards the loch side? Technically, could it be? Proposed house. And I'm not going back to page, the alternative plan that we know isn't the plan now, but and nearer the, I mean, the if we look at that where we are there with the big shed, right, which is the grey building to the right of the application site, the pink application site, and to the left of the farmhouse, is it?
When you say technically, I'm assuming you're saying it would be provided with the same means of access to the site.
Yes, yes.
And all the technical aspects. There's certainly nothing in the papers which would suggest to me that there would be, shall we say, a problem technically, I mean solely technically, not in policy, of the house being in a different position within the red area, with the possible exception of whether or not, as a detailed application, it would again be in any way in conflict with the consent for the landscaping area for the chalets.
Yes, yes, indeed. I was going to come on to that. I know that we have an application that's before us, and what we have before us is what we're considering. But since the sighting of the house has already been referred to, I think it's a relevant question. Now, just to go on to the chalet area issue, right, and I'm still sticking on page 437 of the pink or light red shaded area, which bit of that is affected by the... calling it the chalet issue.
Probably is actually... you turn to page... sorry, so many plans. You turn to page 401... can see there's a line in, if I describe it as an orange line as opposed to a red line, which cuts from the chalet development into the application site.
Is that the dotted line?
Well, there's a dotted circular line.
Yes.
And it's a more continuous line running parallel to that western boundary and slightly dull.
Right. So there's an orange.
Yes, the orange line. Basically, between the orange line and the red line of the application site, I understand is the area which is indicatively showing some planting in it, which is part of the original approved planting scheme for the chalet development.
Which hasn't yet proceeded?
There's no obvious no.
No. Okay. Thank you. Do we have any further questions?
No, convener.
Not for me, convener, no.
I'm going to say, are you sure? Because that was a hesitant no. Do we consider we've enough information given the presentation and the written material that we've had and the further information we've had that we requested to take a decision to. Councillor McCall.
Yes, I think we do. Sorry. Yes, I do.
I disagree, Convener. I'm happy with all the information we have here. It strikes me, if you look at page 437, there are a range of buildings in this area. It seems to me to be quite a busy part of the countryside, and I'm struggling a little bit with deciding whether it is infill or not, and to identify from the plans where all the boundaries are and how it mixes with all the other different shapes and sizes of buildings. So I think I would prefer to have a site visit to be absolutely clear in these bits before.
Well, under the LRB rules, if somebody asks for a site visit, the clock stops and we go on a site visit. So, Mr. Matthew, we're coming on a site visit. That'll be an unaccompanied. Mr. Harrison will be with us to keep us right, but we don't take the applicant and the planner and have a debate on site. We're there simply as fact finding, and I take Councillor Simpson's point. Given the history of this, and I'm sorry you've not got a decision today, but the application is there for further consideration, and we'll carry out a site visit. Can we just stop? Okay. Thank you for your attendance, and thank you everybody for their participation. It's a rare moment when the LRB is able to finish at 12 o'clock. But my prediction, David, you shook your head when I said I think we'll finish in the morning, so I think for once I was correct. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, everybody.